Si quieres transformar tu cuerpo para así dominar tu vida, bienvenido, bienvenida a El Plantívoro Podcast.
Okay, so this is the first episode of this podcast. I wouldn't know how to say the name in English, the Plantívoro Podcast. And I'm with Laura, she's from Austria. And she is, we could say, plant-based. We were just discussing that. She's not fully vegan. She's not fully vegetarian. And we're going to discuss a little bit about that. And yeah, how are you today?
I'm very good. I'm in a good mood to talk.
Good. We just talked like for about an hour. So we're keeping on talking. We're already warmed up. And I haven't asked you this because I wanted to be on the record. Tell me about how you started moving towards a plant-based lifestyle.
That was like that started with my with me being a scout. This is a huge part of my life. Like I started being a scout when I was 5 years old, which kind of like raised me in a very environmentally aware way, I would say. Like I was always aware that my nature is a huge part of me and I'm a huge part of the nature. And I also like I'm a kind of person who always prepare their own meals, so it's hard to ignore what you eat. You see it and you make it all day long.
Okay, and you don't like cooking animals?
I do. Like, I don't have a problem with it. It just, I remember I decided to be vegetarian when I was like 14 years old, and it was because of the animals, and I liked them so much, and I couldn't hold it through barbecue season, to be honest.
Okay.
That was hard. And the second time I became a vegetarian, it was very, very spontaneously. Like, I was at a workshop, and I just decided to sign up as vegetarian, and then I kept going on for 3 years.
Okay, so you didn't really plan it, you just said vegetarian.
Yeah.
And why'd you do that?
Some of the reasons are stupid because, first of all, the line at the meat meals were longer. And second, I thought it's such an easy change. Like, in that moment, I was like having a spiritual thought. I don't know. I was thinking like, it's so easy not to eat meat. And I think I just had a discussion with a guy who told me how he's like, it's impossible for him to get rid of it or not eat meat. And I thought like, this is stupid to be so caged like, within your own needs.
Yes.
I like to be in control of my needs, kind of. And I thought I also want to be in control of my need or my want to eat meat.
And really, really quickly about this guy, I bet that he never even tried to eat meat. Or did he?
I don't know. Like, I can't remember. But of course, it's like they speak quite easily, these people.
Yeah,
They never try. And they had days where they went through without meat. Without even knowing.
Okay, this is something that I really want to talk about, and it's the social part of being plant-based.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think? I mean, I don't know if in Europe it's easier to be plant-based. Do you get a lot of comments? Do you get the comment that you're going to die or that you're going to be nutrient deficient, or what do you get?
Of course. I feel like this was the most interesting part for me about being vegan or being vegetarian, because I was vegetarian for 3 years and 1.5 years I was vegan as well. And the hardest parts for me were like how people reacted. I didn't know that the reactions are going to be that strong, because I remember that during that time, I mostly had conversations about what I eat.
Mm-hmm.
And people like, even I wasn't the one making a deal out of it. I have to say that. Like at the beginning, I talked to some friends, telling them about what I do in life, which is normal, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But at parties, it was the other people coming up to me, asking me about what I eat. And I never asked them. Like, it's not that I forced it on them, but they came to me. And it was annoying and it was exhausting because, as you said, they told me I'm going to die. They told me that they can't do it. And they told me that it's very risky. And they told me that when I will have a child, I will have to stop because it's really unhealthy for my baby, which I'm not.
Yeah.
I was 19. And also they told me like, it was, it's people who are not doctors or anything giving me like advice on my nutrition and everything. And even though some people were like overweight or like you could see that their diet is not healthy.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not that all overweight people are on an unhealthy diet, but like people who really ate only shit told me that I will be so weak and I won't be able, and this is going to be so bad. And they actually, people started talking about with me about my poop. And I was interesting. Wow. Like study colleagues. And I was like, they actually asked me like how my farts smell. And I was like, I don't know why these.
Do you want to smell it right now?
Like, shall we? Or, it was really weird. But honestly, I think their question helped me realize how it actually affects me. Because I heard all these shit about the nutrition, that was all actually the reason why I went to the doctor every like 3 months to get my blood tested. And I actually saw that things are working on fine. Like, I don't know, I never had any problems. Like, the only thing they told me is that I should eat less sugar, and that's not about being vegan. That's exactly. Like, about me liking cakes.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And just as a comment, I also haven't had any problems regarding nutrition. On the contrary, I've had some benefits to eliminating certain animal products.
Yeah. Like, I saw also a lot of advantages. Like, I saw that I'm spending less on food, which to many people seemed weird because all these soy products are so expensive. Mm-hmm. And also, I ate more when I was a vegan or a vegetarian. Like, the amount of food I ate was more, but still it was cheaper. Another advantage I saw, I always said, when I had a meal with meat and I'm full, I'm like definitely full. I'll sit on the couch for an hour and it's going to be like exhausting.
Yeah.
But when I had a meal of vegan stuff and I got full and I even had like two plates and not only one, I considered myself as full, but I would still have been able to run around the house once.
Yeah, you have energy. It doesn't take as much energy to digest plant foods than animals.
It was really weird. Like, this came really shocking to me because I'm a lazy person, and I always thought that this is how it's supposed to be. Like, when you're full, you're also exhausted.
Yeah.
But I wasn't.
And that's one thing about trying different things, that you're in a current state that you think is what's normal. But it's not until you change things up with your life or your nutrition that you realize that there are other states that may be even better than what you're used to. Because you were used to feeling full and just wanting to lie down, right?
Yeah.
And that changed.
Yeah, it changed a lot. It actually made me become a less lazy person because I'm really lazy, but I was always in a mood to go outside of the food. And yeah, I saw also, as I said, like one big part of me, or like one reason why I became vegan that time was because I wanted to see what is inside the product I eat.
Exactly.
Because you usually never turn around the shit you buy in supermarket. And I was really surprised sometimes. For example, there's fish sauce in things. And really? Fish sauce is not a thing people know about or anything. And it just pops up and it's a surprise. Or milk. They put like milk powder in almost everything.
It's very annoying. Very, very annoying.
Yeah. And it made me aware not only how much milk and meat is inside of things, but also how much chemicals. Like, this was also another thing I realized when I was a vegan, how much shit is like conserved with very, very strong chemicals. Like, things you don't even know what it is when you read it.
And which is not only bad for you, I guess it's bad for the environment too.
Yeah, of course, both. But it's also bad for me. It's also like, what the fuck? Like, I wanted to eat some chicken and not like antibiotics. You do you.
Exactly. And another thing that, okay, so let's say that we cover nutrition. It's fine. You don't have any problem with it. Please stop asking. What I want to ask too is that you are very into the environmental movement too. So regarding meat and animal products, why does it help to remove them from your diet, the environment?
Because producing meat takes way more energy than producing like vegan products. Because like, if you want to raise a cow and you have to feed it for a couple of years, that's just like the amount of plants you yourself would eat like in, I don't know, 150 years, I think.
Exactly.
It's like, it just takes a lot of energy. It takes a lot of water. Also, animals produce gas themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And as I said before, we have this thing in Austria. A lot of people eat, or they say that they only eat organic meat and they are super proud of it. But organic meat takes its place and it takes its time. And if you would take the amount of meat Austrians eat today and you would only produce it in like you would only produce organic meat to please these needs, you would need like 70% of the land of Austria to produce it. So it's like, it takes up space. Mm-hmm. We're running out of space because we're having overpopulation as well. And it takes up energy and it takes up farmers. And still the farmers in Austria, for example, like the small farmers, the good farmers, the not mass producing farmers, they are not paid enough. Mm-hmm. And it's not for them. Most of them have to kind of like close down because these big energy taking companies are running them out.
Exactly. So we always have this picture of this happy cow and this happy farm, which is not like that. As we move on, less and less of those happy farms exist. And like 98% of the market is big industries which do not treat the animal well. If you care about animals, I know some don't, some do. But that was the environmental part of the aspect of being plant-based. Now, I want to ask you another part, which is kind of more like the ethical. We were just discussing that. Yeah. You're not that much of I feel for this animal. Not that much. But you do think it's weird that we take the milk of a cow, right?
Yeah. Like, I think, how to say this, I would say I'm okay with animals dying, and I'm okay with the idea of hunting because animals hunt animals as well. And mm-hmm. like animals feed themselves from other animals, like insects and shit. Like these are things that happen. So I'm not feeling shitty for humans who hunt. If they hunt the right thing, like if they hunt happy animals that are not threatened to be
endangered. Yeah.
Yeah. But I don't. Like, as you said, I don't like the part where you take the milk of the cow because I think this is super weird. Like, I'm kind of fine with, like, killing the cow after the cow had a happy life and was, like, doing its own thing, living its own life. And then when it ends, because it has to end one day, okay, you might eat it. But I think it's super weird to, like, milk the cow their whole lives or to, like, make chickens have their period more often just so you can eat it. It's really weird when you think about it.
Yeah.
And I don't know, of course, a lot of people did that, but if you would compare this to humans or to pet animals, like you would never drink the milk of your cat. You would give her milk from a cow, which is weird. It makes no sense.
Yeah.
It just doesn't, because this is kind of like, for me, it's raping the child of the cow because the little cow is the one who's supposed to get the milk.
Exactly. And you just take him away or her.
Yeah. And even if I don't take it away from the baby cow, it does something to the cow that I keep on milking it.
Yeah.
Like, it changes the genes and whatever, and they will produce way too much milk. And this is weird.
Yeah.
Just so I can have my cappuccino.
Exactly.
This is always one of the things I really like. Like, animals, they have to suffer a lot. So we are pleased for this one little thing.
Yeah.
Because I like my cappuccino way better with cow milk than with soy milk.
Mm-hmm.
And for this little small moment of pleasure, I am willing to sacrifice the life of a cow.
Yeah. And when you're talking about milk, it's not sacrificing the life. It's just
a
life that's miserable for a long, long time.
Yeah. Like, my opinion is this sounds hard, but I'd rather kill the cow than, like, milk it for 20 years.
Exactly. That's a good respectable opinion. And now, just like a parenthesis, there are a lot of options, a lot of plant-based options, which are delicious. If anyone's listening that I don't know what to replace cow's milk with, I can give you 20 options. Soy milk, oat milk, almond milk, hazelnut milk, hemp
milk,
coconut milk, etc. Just try and choose whatever you like best. But I was going to ask you, like, moving on from the cow thing and more into the I am 90% vegan or 90% vegetarian, or I eat mostly plant foods, which I am very okay with. And I want people to understand that this is a very, very good approach rather than just saying, oh, I'm not going to do it. I'm never going to be vegan or never going to be vegetarian.
I think this is a problem a lot of people have. Like all these guys who say, I could never do it because I like meat so much. They don't see that you don't have to live your life forever without meat. You just reduce it. If you can reduce it for like 10 or 20%, you're already doing fine because you're already doing better than before.
Exactly.
And like the way I eat, I don't know. I think people, I'm not the only one who has this craving, like at 2 a.m. to have like a Nutella piece of bread or whatever. So like what I eat and how I eat, this is not science. This is what my body wants from me. And this is like the moods I'm in or whatever. So I don't have a book where I like look up and, this week I have to eat 2 pumpkins. I just eat what I want. But when I get hungry, I use these 3 seconds to turn it around and see what is it.
Okay.
It's not that hard. It's not like you have to make up a philosophy or anything. You can just take 5 more seconds before you eat something.
Exactly.
It's really easy, actually.
And just doing like some meals, some recipes that are plant-based could be very, very beneficial.
I think people stop being proud of themselves when they kind of like leave out the ham out of the sandwich and just eat it with vegetables. But that's also a step in the right direction. Yeah. Like you don't have to overdo it. You have to do as much as you can do. That's it.
Exactly. And also like get informed, you know, just not take out the meat and leave the rice, you know, just maybe add some chickpeas or beans or some other kind of protein. Just don't do it without being informed, but do take small steps and get informed, I would say. And just to kind of get into the end of the podcast, I would like to ask you to give us advice on how to be not vegan, not vegetarian, but more towards a plant-based lifestyle in like a more concrete steps that maybe work for you or that could work for someone.
I don't know. Like I work with children. Children are huge fans of hamburgers or anything. Like they love meat and they hate all kind of vegetables. And what I do with them is like when I prepare a meal for them and they tell me their wishes, I make them like choose one vegetable which we should add to the meal. And then they kind of like receive different levels and sometimes they choose 2 vegetables and then sometimes we're already able to leave out the meat kind of. So I like to see these things as a game. It's not something I have to follow and it's not my duty, but it's fun to have like one green thing in every meal.
Okay.
It's kind of like, I don't know, playing Candy Crush or something. You have to put the colors together. And if you manage to have like more than 3 colors in your meal, you're doing fine.
Good. Yeah.
And it's easy and it looks nice.
Okay. So more like challenges, not like rules, like challenges,
yeah.
You know?
Challenges is a good word. That's how we've been raised or like that's how we do it with the kids because I think placebo is something that's a huge thing. Like it's really easy to trick yourself into something.
Yeah, exactly.
Very easy. And it's fun as well. Like if you challenge yourself to eat like 1 yellow, 1 red, and 1 green thing per day.
Perfect.
Easy.
That's great advice. Eat 1 yellow, 1 green, and 1 red vegetable every day and then you'll be moving towards a plant-based lifestyle.
Yeah. And then you have like long-term challenges. Like every month you have to eat 1 kind of vegetable you've never eaten before. Because you would be surprised.
Yeah.
Like I once did a challenge where I had to write down all the vegetables I know to see how many you can get. And I did it with a friend who was able to list like 10 and I had like 59 because you just,
whoa.
Yeah. I mean, okay, you can have like white onion and red onion.
Yeah, yeah.
But still, if you do it and then you try, for example, I hate fenchi. I don't know if you know it. It's like a root and it has a very strong, intense taste. And I don't like it at all, but I eat it every 2 months once because I dislike it so much and I actually feel sorry for it. I feel like sometimes, I'm leaving you out.
Okay, come in to my body. Okay,
I can mix you with the sweet potatoes and it's going to be fine.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
that's great advice. Okay, so now before we go, I just want you to give us, as we've already done before, a piece of life advice, but you can't copy what we've already discussed in the last episode.
Okay, I'm thinking what kind of life advice I can give. I'm allowed to say something which is off topic, right?
Yeah, of course.
Okay, like there's one, it's not really advice, but it's a finding I had, which is very interesting. They told me that you are unable to feel fear when you're singing.
Oh, good.
So it's actually really good to know to, like whenever you're in panic or something uncomfortable is happening and you have to tell your boss you don't want to work there anymore, if you start singing in your head, it actually makes you, like, it prevents you from feeling the fear, which is cool.